The topic I will be speaking about is a topic that has been puzzling me for a very long time. Well, since my student days, actually, when I learned quantum mechanics. And at a certain point, the subject of indistinguishable particles, identical quantum particles, was introduced. And well, the textbooks made it clear that these quantum particles, these identical quantum particles, that is, particles of the same kind, let's say electrons or protons sharing their intrinsic properties, are objects of a completely different kind compared to particles as we are used to them in classical physics. And I've been thinking about these things for a very long time, and my thinking took a turn when, in 1998, I had a student, Andrea Lubendink, who probably is among the audience now, who wrote a thesis about this subject. And so let me go to my first slide. At the bottom, you see this master thesis in 1998. There, the idea was introduced that changed my thinking about this subject. Andrea and I have published a couple of papers about these ideas. First one dating back to 2011. Another paper appeared a year ago. I'm not quite sure whether it has been published in print, but it's available online. And there are some other papers that I wrote about the same subject. And later I discovered that some of these ideas, in fact, had also been published by Chiaradi, Marinato, and Weber in 2002. And in this talk, I will make use of some of their more technical results. So what is the overview of what I will do today? First, I will sketch a brief history of the subject. What are identical quantum particles and why are they so special? Then I will discuss the so-called received view concerning them, concerning their nature. And this received view says that such particles are indistinguishable objects. Well, it is a very strange concept. And that's admitted, of course, in this received view. And people usually say that this requires a kind of revolution in our thinking, novel ways of thinking, and perhaps even the development of new mathematics and new systems of logic, new systems of reasoning. Then I will introduce the alternative approach, to which I already alluded. And according to this alternative approach, identical particles, quantum particles, are just distinguishable objects. But, and that's an important proviso, the concept of a particle is not always applicable to systems described by quantum mechanics. So, as I will explain, particles should be seen as a concept that emerges. And in the most general situations, we cannot say that the world described by quantum mechanics can be represented as a system of particles. And in the end, I will say something more about this concept of emergence and what factors play a role there. And of course, I will conclude with a conclusion. So let's delve into a bit of this history. So this will be very quick and a bit superficial. In 1900, Planck introduced his radiation law, of course, and he kept on working on the subject and try to find a theoretical justification for this radiation law. And in order to justify that law from a theoretical point of view, he studied radiation, think of light, electromagnetic radiation, in a cavity, radiation that is in thermal equilibrium with the walls of the cavity. And Planck applied statistical thermodynamics to the problem and posed himself the problem of in how many ways a total amount of energy, here indicated by P times epsilon, can be distributed over the number of resonators in the wall of this cavity. n resonators and the p times epsilon is the total amount of energy. Now, in this calculation, Planck wanted to find the entropy of the energy in the and therefore he had to calculate this number w, because the entropy is given by the logarithm of this number of possibilities. In this calculation, Planck considered the resonators in the wall as, well, yes, classical physically distinct objects, which is reasonable, of course. If you change in an energy distribution two of the resonators, well, you get a classically completely different situations. The energy that was first, let's say, at one position in the wall ends up at another position in the wall. So that's completely different. But the elements epsilon of the energy were treated by Planck as indistinguishable. And that had a technical meaning in the computation of the total amount of possibilities, the total number of possibilities. He considered these epsilons as permutable. But Planck didn't go into much detail about the calculation. He just wrote down a formula. That's the formula that I have here for this W. And he took this formula from a mathematics book, combinatorics text. And the sequence to this story is interesting because many people, many physicists found it, well, unclear, rather opaque, what the background of this formula was. And that motivated two famous physicists, Ehrenfest, and well, this name is perhaps difficult to pronounce for most of you, but also a very famous physicist, Kamerlingh Onnes, who got the Nobel Prize for the liquefaction of helium, actually. The situation motivated these two physicists, Ehrenfest and Kamerlingh Onnes, to look into the background of this formula. And they wrote a short article about this in 1914. Here I have the title of this article, Simplified Deduction of the Formula from the Theory of Combinations, which Planck used as the basis of his radiation theory. Here we have a little picture. Here we see Ehrenfest on the left-hand side of the blackboard. This is Kamerlingh Onnes and, well, celebrities all around here. But the important point for us now is that they introduce symbols of this kind, symbol that I have here, to represent a distribution of energy. And the symbol that I've written out here represents a situation in which there are four oscillators. The first one is represented by the space between the bar on the left-hand side and the first circle. The circle functions as a kind of separator between two oscillators. Then here, this space indicates the second oscillator, resonator. Here, we have a space for the third resonator, and we here there is a space for the fourth resonator. So this picture here, this symbol, represents a situation in which we have four resonators with the total amount of, well, you can count the number of symbols here. Seven times epsilon is the total amount of energy that's represented here in this picture. Now, the idea is that each distribution of energy corresponds to exactly one such symbol. How many symbols are there given a total amount of energy and given a total number of resonators? Well, if there are n resonators, there are n minus one of these little circles that separate them. There are p times epsilon, there are p of these epsilon symbols. So the total elements here that can be given in different position is the sum of these two things, that's n minus one plus p. But each permutation of the epsilons among each other and the little circles among each other, well, leaves the symbol exactly as it was, so the form of the symbol doesn't change. So we have to divide by the factorials of those numbers, and that leads us to the formula that I've reproduced here again, which is of course the same one as Planck had written down. But now it's becoming clear exactly how you calculate this number. and what the conceptual background is. And in fact, Eerfest and his co-author commented on this in an appendix to their article, which actually is much longer than their calculation and proof of the formula itself. And here I have cited some passages from this appendix. What they say is that the permutability of these elements epsilon, which apparently is part of Planck's reasoning, implies that these epsilons do not represent individual physical objects. And so I've written out the whole passage here. They say the permutation of these elements epsilon is a purely formal device, just as the permutation of the elements of the little circles is. The circles were the separators between the resonators. And now they warn against a misunderstanding. They say, more than once, the analogous, equally formed device used by Planck, so they refer back to Planck's article, namely the distribution of P energy elements of N resonators, has by a misunderstanding been given a physical interpretation. And this misunderstanding is that these epsilons are seen as a kind of physical object, as individuals, as particles. But they say Planck does not deal with mutually free quanta epsilon. The resolution of the multiples of epsilon in the total energy that must be, the resolution of the multiples of epsilon in separate elements epsilon, this is essential in this method. And the introduction of these separate elements have to be taken with a grain of salt. It's simply a formal device. The real object which is counted remains a number of all the different distributions of N resonators over the different energy grades with a given total energy. And so they conclude that these epsilons cannot be interpreted in the sense of what Einstein had introduced in 1905, namely light quanta, as Einstein called them, what he would call photons perhaps. Now, they warn against the misinterpretation, as they see it, that these epsilons stand for physical objects. Actually, that's very close to the way Planck himself thought, because he had introduced in these calculations, he made that clear in his text, as just a mathematical device to come up with a definite number for the number of possibilities. If you treat energy as a continuum, a continuous quantity, then it's very difficult to apply standard mathematics to the situation and to come up with this number of possibilities. So also for Planck himself, it was not clear what the interpretation of these epsilons was. But EFS, gambling on this, now take a definite stand on this and say they cannot be considered to be physical. That brings me to an important analogy. So how should we look upon these epsilons and the whole procedure? Well, things become very clear, I think, and visualizable if you think of an analogy that was suggested by Schrödinger in 1950. So that's much later, of course. So Schrödinger compared the situation to the one that we have if we consider money in a bank account. Now, I'm not thinking of a kind of, how do you call it, a piggy bank in which you put coins. No, I'm thinking of, modern money, deposit money, which doesn't exist in a physical form. So they're not coins, it's deposit money. So the number that appears on your bank account, the balance of your account. So think of a total amount of money distributed over n bank accounts. So that's the analogy for the total energy that's distributed over these resonators. Now, it does not make sense, if I have money in my bank, well, a certain sum of money, to think about the individual euros, in my case, in this account. The only thing that counts and that has meaning is the total amount of money in this account. And if you ask yourself, which are the things that are individual and distinguishable in this situation? Well, those are the accounts that differ from each other on account by virtue of the different owners they have, or the different amounts that are in them, or the different banks that house them, things like that. And we can repeat exactly the same reasoning as we just saw in the case of Planck, but now for the case of money. If we are interested in the number of ways in which the total amount of money can be distributed, well, so I repeat now the sentence that we had in the Kamling Honors and Ehrenfest paper. The real object which is counted is the number of all the different distributions of n accounts of the amounts, we'll give the amounts of 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on, with a given total sum of money P. And that brings me to the following picture. Suppose you have some mother account. I'm already here explaining a bit of the details of the alternative proposal to the receive view that I will go into a bit later. Here you already have the main idea. Suppose you have an undifferentiated mother account with a total amount of money. You can imagine transfers to different bank accounts. And then, because these bank accounts are individuals, you can distinguish the different amounts of money in these different accounts. So their address, so to speak, is given by these account and the account numbers and the bank and the owners and so on. And in this way, a total undifferentiated whole can become split up in things that to some extent, at least, are possessing an identity. And you can think of the situation in which some of these accounts harbor only, they have in them only 1 euro. Well, then you can speak about that single euro in the account of John or whatever. So in this picture, there are no individual euro entities, but there are individual accounts. And in certain situations, the individuality of the account can be taken over by the amount of money that's in the account. Now, going back to the physics, so this was just an analogy with amounts of money, which makes it very easy to think of about the situation, I think. Going back to the physics, the whole history took a dramatic turn, so to speak, in 1924. It's a very famous episode in the history of physics when Bose from India wrote to Einstein with a new derivation of Planck's radiation law. And in this case, in this paper, he applied this new counting method that Planck had applied to these energy elements epsilon, considered as non-individuals. Bose applied that same method to photons, light quanta, in the cavity. So he thought of these things as a kind of particles, but obeying a non-standard statistics. And this was taken over. So the story is that Einstein translated that paper in German and was published in German physics journal, Annalen der Physik, I'm not sure about the journal. So that's Planck's law and the hypothesis of light quanta. That's the title of the English version of that paper. And then Einstein himself generalized the idea and applied the new counting, originally introduced for these epsilon elements, to atoms in a gas. And he came up with the paper, The Quantum Theory of the Monoatomic Ideal Gas. Now, atoms in a gas, of course, are particles. If you look at this with spectacles, with glasses that are classically colored, so to speak, atoms in a gas are particles par excellence, particles par excellence. So these are the paradigmatic particles. So this Einstein paper really strongly suggests that quantum particles are something very special. They don't obey classical counting. They are permutable and really indistinguishable. And they obey new statistics. And so this is the beginning, I think, of this idea that the particles in quantum mechanics are something very special, and there's something mystifying about that. We'll go into that in a moment. So this leads us to, I'm now making an enormous jump in time, but this leads us to what is called in literature, in the philosophical literature, I should say, because there's not much explicit discussion about these things in the physics literature, what's called the received view. And I've here taken over a passage from a well-known book by Stephen French and Dejo Krause, 2006, in which they discuss many aspects of indistinguishability and quantum particles versus classical particles. And they say in this book, particles, as a result of this quantum evolution, can no longer be considered to be individuals. They are, in some sense, they effectively say, non-individuals. This conclusion expresses what we have called the received view. Classical particles are individuals, no question about that, but quantum particles are not. There is a mathematical background with that, so I'm now switching to the discussion from the point of view of modern physics. If you look at the mathematics of the quantum formalism, there's a clear link there to this received view. And that's via what they call the symmetrization postulates. But states, quantum states of particles of the same sort, identical particles as they're usually called, must be either symmetric for bosons or anti-symmetric. That applies to the case of fermions. And here I've written down such a state. So we have a two-particle state. I'm just following the usual way of speaking about this. Psi. This would apply to the case of bosons because this state has been symmetrized. And so there are two states, single particle states involved, the state that I've indicated with G and one indicated by R. And you can think of colors, green and red. There's a one and a two appearing in the formula. And these one and two, well, first of all, refer to the vector spaces, the total Hilbert space in which this total state is defined. This total Hilbert space has a tensor product structure, as I've written down here. It can be written as the product, tensor product, of two single particle Hilbert spaces, and the one and two appearing in the formula here are refer to these individual spaces. So from a mathematical point of view, there is no question about the meaning of this one and two. They refer to the Hilbert spaces, mathematically well-defined objects. But the problems arise when we do what's usual in the quantum mechanics literature and also in the philosophical literature surrounding this, namely to interpret these labels, indices one and two, as particle labels. So that's the standard procedure to think of one and two as labels of particles. But that, of course, has the consequence that particle one, so in the, referred to by this one here, well, must have the same properties as particle two. The state is completely symmetrical in this one and two. Everything that can be said about particle one can also be said about particle two. You could say they share equally in these green and red properties. That's just the symmetry of the situation. And that gives you a kind of mathematical background to this doctrine of indistinguishability. The individual particles are in exactly the same state. And you can work that out a little bit more formally. So, This lack of individuating power of these labels is also expressed by the equality of the so-called reduced state. So here I have the same state again, two-particle state. And now you can deduce from this total state descriptions of the individual particles by a procedure which is called the tracing out of the degrees of freedom that do not pertain to the particle that is considered. And what you end up with in them is our so-called density matrices. So there's a density matrix for particle one and a density matrix for particle two. And what you see here is that these two density matrices represent the states of these individual particles are exactly the same. And they are exactly what you expect intuitively on the basis of what I just told you. They you could say they are divided equally about the two properties represented in the state, the G and the R, the green and the red property. So this, the interpretation of these labels, 1, 2 as particle labels, not only as labels of vector spaces, but also as particle labels, has this strange consequence that all particles are in exactly the same state. So this doctrine that these labels are particle labels has been called factorism for clear reasons. There actually are the labels of the vector spaces. And if you also consider them to be particle labels, well, you end up with factorist particles. That's a terminology that was introduced by Adam Colton in a paper that I forgot to mention on my first slide. But anyway, so this is the factorist doctrine. So here I have another example, but now instead of these scholars, I'm thinking of one particle, of one state that's located on the far right, left, and another that's located at the far right. So these are, I'm thinking here of localized states. And I try to represent two fermions at a large distance from each other. That's the way people usually speak in the practice of physics. Well, because of the anti-symmetrization in this case, this state should have this form. But if we apply the received view that I just explained to this state, then we end up with the idea that the two particles represented by 1 and 2 are in exactly the same state. They are equally distributed over these two locations on the far left and the far right. And already at this point, you see that there is something strange with this interpretation. As soon as you really start to think about it, which is not something that often is done in perhaps I'm exaggerating now a little bit, but very often in the practice of physics, these things are just accepted and one doesn't pay much attention to them. In the practice of physics, well, for what you can see is that for a moment at least, this receive view is often suspended, and one thinks of this state as representing one particle on the left and one particle on the right. And that actually is borne out if you look at what is found in experiments. If you perform location experiments, so you're trying to find out where is something, then you will find, something on the left, on the far left, and something on the far right. And it's very reasonable to think about these findings in terms of a particle finding itself on the left-hand side and a particle finding itself on the right-hand side. But as soon as you start to think in this way, if you think, well, this is really the representation of what we think of as a situation in which there's a particle on the left and a particle on the right, then you must accept that you are no longer considering these labels, 1 and 2, as particle labels. Because as I explained, as soon as you do that, you must conclude that the particles are in exactly the same state, equally distributed over the left-hand side and the right-hand side. That's not at all the way that this is discussed in the practice of physics. So there's a certain tension here you already see now between this received view and kind of intuitive thinking, physical thinking, about what's the situation here. And to be a bit more systematic about this, I've here listed a number of problems with the received view. Now, as I already said, you do not find many explicit perhaps no explicit discussions at all. You, So you find allusions and let's say intuitive statements about the situations, and hardly any real analysis of what this received view means. So what can you find in the literature? Well, very rarely people say that indeed, particles must all be in the same state. You can calculate these reduced states. So they must share all their properties. But that's a very strange thing, if you think about it, because that means that you can never go over to the situation in classical physics in which particles do have distinguishing properties. So each particle can be distinguished by position and in most cases also by other properties. But it doesn't matter what the limiting procedure is. If you start with this quantum picture in which particles are exactly the same, you always end up with, even in the limiting situation, with particles that also are exactly the same, and that can never be classical particles. So there is something strange here if you want to a smooth transition between quantum particles and classical particles. Another thing that you very often find in the physics literature, even very advanced and frontier research at the edge of modern science, then you find statements like for the case that I just discussed. There is one particle on the left and there is one particle on the right, but we can never know which of them is particle one and which is particle two. That's very standard to say things like that. But that's really inconsistent, because on the one hand, you do use, in this case, you do use these labels one and two as particle labels, but then you must also accept that the properties of these particles are exactly the same. And that makes it inconsistent to think that they can be on one side or the other, but that you can never find out which one is which. So that's not really adequate and even consistent. And then the third option that you sometimes find, for instance, in the book by Fiennes and Kjaus, although statements of type two can also be found in that book, so it's not completely consistent, I think. But in the more serious passages, so to speak, what you find is that a Fock space structure is introduced. And this refers to quantum field theory. I'm not quite sure about the background of the audience, so I don't want to assume too much about that. But the idea is that you have states, and these states are populated by particles, but you distinguish the first thing that you distinguish are the different states. In quantum field theory, you would say these different states have certain occupation numbers, but the received view that I'm discussing here goes a little bit further than that. It says that there are particles in those states that form what they call quasi sets. They are collections of entities, and here's where the new reasoning and the new logic, the new mathematics comes in, to which I alluded in the very beginning of my talk. Quasi sets, collections of entities that have cardinal numbers, so you can speak about the total number of entities that's in the set, but they are no ordinals, so you cannot number them. This brings us actually very close to the picture of euros in a bank account that I discussed earlier. But it remains mysterious here why you should speak about different entities in these states, and to introduce the concept of quasi-sets for these entities. And instead of just saying that there is a total number of mass of energy or something like that, in the way Planck and Gamelin-Onnes did, as I explained in the beginning. Now, the alternative. So there are certain problems with the EC2. So this is the alternative that I already mentioned. So what I propose, and these articles and the old master thesis also propose things in this in the same direction, is to think of the general situation as one in which there are no individual particles, in which there is a total amount of money, so to speak, if I use this Schrödinger analogy. But in certain situations, this total amount is split up in different states, different bank accounts, and some of these states contain only one amount of energy, one quantum, so to speak. And in those situations, you can speak about a particle having this or that property. So in this picture here, I've sketched three cases of that kind. So three particles that are emerging here, namely this blue one, the black one here, and this purple one here. They are individuated by the states in which they are. Well, that's a way of speaking. I should really say that there are states with this, which have been occupied once. But you can also have bigger amounts of energy, mass, and so on in other states. I think this gives an intuitively acceptable picture, and it is very close to how in physical practice particles are discussed. And actually, these one particle states can without any problem be taken over to the in the classical limit, in the classical limiting case, to the classical particle. So it's in principle possible to if you take the classical limit, to make classical particles out of these once occupied quantum states. But as you already see in this picture, and that's something I want to discuss in a moment, this proposal makes particles emergent. So they are not basic constituents of the world, they only arise in certain circumstances, and we will have to discuss a little bit more what these circumstances are. But before doing that, I would like to point out that there is, and this to some extent goes back to this paper by Chiardi and others, but that there is a precise mathematical formalism behind this proposal, and that applies in particular to the case of fermions. As you will remember, in the case of fermions, you have of course the anti-symmetry. So fermion state should be anti-symmetrized, and that means that states have the form like that. That each state in such a formula, in such a symmetrized product state, is occupied only once. That's the Pauli exclusion principle. As soon as you have repetition of states here, then you get an annihilation here. So the terms would annihilate each other. So you can only have differences, and that lends itself very well to an interpretation in terms of particles. Now, states of this kind, so I can only make allusions, rather superficial reference to the formalism and the mathematics behind this, can be written in this form, what they call a wedge form, which makes it very plausible and easy to interpret them as one entity, one particle in state A and one particle in state B. And this can be done also if there are more factors. So symmetrized product states, the ones you have on the, by virtue of the empty symmetrization postulate, can be written as wedge states, which have all the properties, it turns out, that you expect from particles, product states of particles. So in this case, one particle in state A, one particle in state B. And this can be generalized to the case of many more particles. So here I've something more about the same thing. So if we have this batch state, it's possible to attribute pure states in single system Hilbert spaces, not to the components. You can then assign particle labels, but these are not the vector space labels that we saw before. These are labels that we can assign on the basis of the states, the different properties that are represented in this total product. And then, and this is something that goes back to Chiardi and his co-workers, if you have states of this kind, well, they behave, I would almost say, in all respects like classical particle states. In particular, they don't violate the Bell inequalities. There's no entanglement between the different particles, the different states, as long as we confine ourselves in EPR-like situations to local measurements. This is something that I will come back to in a moment. So what kind of picture arises from this? So fermionic states, these are the easiest to handle in this formulation. You can say the same thing for bosons, but then the possibility is left open that there are states in which there are more quanta, and these defy a simple particle interpretation. But you can also have states that do contain only one quantum. And in that case, even bosons can be described as individual and different particles. But let's restrict ourselves to fermions. So fermionic particles can in this way be individuated by orthogonal one particle states and can be distinguished on the basis of the physical properties. There's always only one particle possessing a certain collection of properties. That's guaranteed by Pauli's exclusion principle. Under free evolution, think of an ideal case or something like that, these states will follow individual trajectories in Hilbert space. So you can even speak about the gen identity of these particles. And so what we end up with is a picture according to which distinct and individual particles of the same kind can be defined. They come close to classical particles, actually. And so this conflicts with what I would call a kind of folklore that's still dominant in the literature, that identical particles are by principle, quantum particles that is, are by principle indistinguishable, lack individuality, cannot possess trajectories, et cetera. So according to this proposal, all these things can be denied. And we get an almost classical picture, at least when we have these wedge products. But now we have to take a closer look at that assumption, because not all states in quantum mechanics are these symmetrized or anti-symmetrized product states. It's a special case to have wedge states. And so these wedge states have an easy interpretation. Here I have another other example of a wedge state that can be written. So this is the I've left out the normalization effect. This state, it took a bit complicated, can be written in this simple wedge form. And so according to what I have just explained and proposed, this has the interpretation that there is one particle on the left with the, let's say, spin up, and one particle on the right with spin down. So in spite of the fact that in the usual representation it looks like an entangled state, you can see that as just a kind of product. But this is a special case, as I already said. Not all states have this wedge form. And here I have an important example of a state that's cannot be interpreted in this way. So that's a bit more complicated than the one we had a moment ago. In this case, and this is the typical EPR state, there's a kind of decoupling between the spatial part. So I'm thinking of this L and R states as referring two localized states on the left-hand side and the right-hand side, respectively. And the spin part, this is the typical singlet state of the EBR type of experiments. And you see that, as I said, the spatial parts and the spin parts are independent of each other. This is just a product form of the two. And in this case, so both on the left-hand side, there's association with the same single states as on the right-hand side. In this case, it's not possible to associate a complete set of single particle properties to L and R, the left-hand side and the right-hand side individually. And that means, according to what I'm proposing here, that the state of this kind cannot really be interpreted as representing a particle on the left-hand side and the right-hand side. There's something global to the total state, which I've tried to indicate here. The spin properties are distributed over the left-hand side and the right-hand side. However, there are many situations, actually, especially when you go to the classical limit, in which a particle picture emerges even from those problematic states that I mentioned a moment ago, in which cannot be written as a wedge product, and so cannot have these classical particle interpretations. And in particular, decoherence plays a role here. So here I have a state of the same kind as I mentioned a moment ago. It's EBR-like state. I've only taken one term now. The spin is distributed over left and right. But suppose that there is an interaction with the environment. So that's the usual assumption of decoherence explanations. That there is an environment and an interaction with the environment, an interaction that's sensitive to the combination of place and spin. Now, many interactions in physics are position dependent. So the sensitivity to position, that's something that you can find quite generally, but that's not very special. And if there's also a sensitivity to spin, so in a way it's a spin measurement, if the environment watches the spin, so to speak, then you will end up schematically with a state of this kind. So the two terms, the one here and the one, if you multiply this with the one here, are decohered, as they say. They become coupled to mutually orthogonal environment states. And now if you make measurements on this total state with only look at the left and right and spin and do not probe the environment, then, well, that's the whole idea of decoherence, then you will find that the whole system behaves as if there were particles. You get a mixture of these two states, and these are exactly these are particle states in which there's a connection between position and spin. So here we have a particle on the left-hand side that has spin up, and a particle on the right-hand side that has spin down, and here the other way around. So there are certain situations, and this depends on the interaction, in which a particle picture becomes applicable, in the sense that if you make measurements on this system, then all the results will be in accordance with the assumption that there are particles with these localized properties. And now there's an interesting philosophical discussion, and I don't have time to go into that now, how to interpret that from a foundational point of view, of also from a philosophical or ontological point of view, whether this is just a pragmatic point that you find these things in the measurement results, or that you can give a deeper significance to it. I myself am inclined to think that this points in the direction of perspectival properties, that this, with respect to certain interactions, well, the system actually has these particle properties, but that's a big subject in itself. So, but what the Yasuyoshi suggests is that the applicability of the particle concept well depends on circumstances, and in that sense, it's contextual. Whether a particle picture is appropriate depends not only on the form of the state, but also on the kind of measurements that you perform, the context in which the system is studied and looked at. And if you think a little bit further about this, then there are other features of the quantum formalism that point in the same direction, I would say. Because consider the following thing. If you have an arbitrary state of this form, this is what they usually call an entangled state, according to most literature, is very different from a product state. It's a completely different mathematical object. That's the standard view. But if you think about it, this state is defined in a total Hilbert space, which is a tensor product, a product space with vector spaces 1 and 2. But if you take another decomposition of this total Hilbert space, it's always possible to find a decomposition, a different factorization of the total Hilbert space, so that this psi becomes a product state in that factorization. That's what I fit in here. So if you take instead of this H1 times in the product, in the tensor product sense, times H2, if you take another factorization, then it will be possible to find one in which this psi becomes a product. And that means that if you look at the system that's described by this state from a certain point of view, using interactions that break the system up in other parts than the original decomposition, the factorization did, then you will find independent parts. So whether a thing is entangled or not depends on the way the system is probed, the way it is investigated, the way interactions are used to investigate the system. The opposite is also true. If you have a product state, very clearly interpretable as representing two individual particles, they may be distinguishable particles even, it's possible to have measurements that mix up this individuality and create correlations, like the correlations that violate Bell inequalities and that make the state into a kind of EPR state. And this connects to recent discussions in quantum information theory about what people call detection-induced entanglement. And I have a very simple example of that here, taken from a paper from 2013, Tichy and co-workers. But there's an enormous amount of literature following this up. So this is still a kind of hot topic. So you start with the two independent sources of, could be photons, but let's say electrons. Now, if you make measurements, local measurements, then what comes out of these two sources will behave in all respects as coming from two individual particles, one localized in B and one localized in A. No question about that. And that's actually the way these situations are usually discussed in the same literature that I just mentioned. So people speak about one individual electron produced by source B and one individual electron produced by source A. And in experiments, well, this picture is borne out. But now think about a more complicated measurement, which involves beam splitters. So that this wave packet that comes out of B is divided in two parts, one ending up in this detector on the left-hand side and one ending up in this detector on the right-hand side. And the same for this the wave packets, I should say, coming from A, that wave packet is also split up in two parts, one going this way and one going that way. Now, if you do that, so you start with a product state or a wedge state. If they are products of the same kind, then what we have is a symmetrized product state. That's what is being discussed here. And you do exactly this. Then what you will find here is a state that violates Bell inequalities. If you make spin measurements on the two electrons, and you can no longer say that the situation here, probed in this way, so these beam splitters I take as part of the probing, the investigating the particle system, you can no longer say that you're dealing with two individual particles in this case. This actually is a variation on an experiment which is already older, I think in 1998, the Hong-Au-Mandel experiment, which is quite famous in particle physics. So it depends on the way you look at it and the context whether a particle picture is applicable or not. So well, I'm having a look at the clock now. So I think I'm just in time. Oh, here's my conclusion. So what I'm suggesting to you, what I'm proposing, is that well, in classical mechanics, particles are fundamental, and they are always distinguishable by individuating bundles of physical properties. That's unproblematic. Now, this same representation can sometimes be used in quantum mechanics, but in quantum mechanics, the applicability of this picture is emergent and context dependent. However, when a particle picture applies, then quantum particles are distinguishable, just as their classical counterparts. And in this case, these quantum particles, think of the fermion case in which I had these wedge products. These quantum particles correspond to orthogonal one particle states rather than to the vector labels occurring in the formalism. And it turns out that as soon as this classical particle picture is not applicable, so if we don't have this emergence and we look at the system in, let's say, in the wrong way, in the non-particulate way, so there's no particle picture that applies, then it's exactly these cases that the typical quantum features like, the Bell correlations that cannot be explained classically, non-locality and so on appear, but there certainly is a regime of quantum mechanics in which the classical particle picture is applicable, but in order to see that, we must leave this factorism and the idea that the labels refer to individual particles, we must leave that behind, and we must identify the particles by the states that occur in the total state. Well, that's what I had to say. I think I've just used 1 hour. Thank you very much.